Hello, I'm Matt Everitt, and you're listening to a brand new series of The First Time here on BBC Six Music and BBC Sounds. This is the show where we meet some of the most influential and best-loved musicians around and take a look at the pivotal first musical moments that made them who they are today. Today's guest is the frontman in one of the most distinctive alternative bands to emerge in the past 20 years. In fact, alternative doesn't really feel like the right word. Maybe the right word is idiosyncratic. They appeared to emerge fully formed on their self-titled debut album in 2008, a collection of literary, melodic and artful songs infused with Afropop rhythms and a distinct production style that set them apart from pretty much everybody. That started a run of brilliant records, often number ones, plus albums, acclaim and a career that's become more and more interesting with every release, including their latest album, Only God Was Above Us. But every time a proud mess, another one. I'm very pleased to welcome to the first time today Ezra Koenig from Vampire Weekend. Here we speak about Ezra's earliest musical influences and parents with excellent musical taste, and his passions for ska, 80s pop and hip-hop. We talk about Vampire Weekend's first rehearsal and first gig and their breakthrough first album. We also cover how they dealt with the attention that that success brought, what it's like winning a couple of Grammys, how they coped with the departure of one of their founding members in 2016, and the future of Vampire Weekend. But I started by asking Ezra, as I do with all my guests, when was the first time he was aware of music?
We always had a piano in the house. So, you know, I have kind of memories of like bashing on the keys.
Because your dad was a big music head, wasn't he?
Yeah, both of my parents loved music, different types of music, but they always had great record collection and they both played a little bit of guitar. So, yeah, there's definitely music present.
Tell me about that record collection.
Well, my mom veered towards classical. It doesn't seem like she was ever too interested in popular music. Where my dad was very respectable, kind of cutting edge up until he had children. And
what's respectable cutting edge? What's that?
Well, like, let's see. My dad was born in 1950 and I was born in 1984, which is when he stopped buying any records. So especially when you look at the, you know, the late 70s, early 80s, he had all the early Talking Heads records and television Marquee Moon and early Run DMC and... He had the original 12-inch of Curtis Blow, The Breaks. Wow. You know, he's like a cool New York guy. So yeah.
Did you have that ritual of putting on music? Because for some families, music's just something you have in the background. And for other families, it's like, well, it's a Saturday afternoon and we're going to put something on now. Which camp were you?
We like the quiet in my family. And I think I'm recreating that in my current family. So, yeah, when we would put on a record, it was a big deal. It was like, let's listen to this. Definitely not having the radio on all the time. So it was kind of exciting if... One of my parents said, oh, you guys should hear this song, and then put it on. So, yeah, it's very, like, kind of focused in that sense.
Yeah. What's the record or what's the track that you're thinking of when I asked you that question then?
Again, in terms of my dad's late 70s excellent taste, he had a 45 of Ian Dury and the Blockheads, which is kind of unusual for an American guy to be a big Ian Dury fan. And he had this song, Hit Me With Your Rhythm Stick.
Yes.
And I don't know why my sister and I... That was the song we wanted to dance to. I don't know, maybe as a kid I found it was like, well, it's a great groove and I think there's something about hit me, hit me, hit me. It was just like, so that was one that we wanted to request and I can still picture the sleeve that has this kind of like cubist Dalmatian or something. So all that stuff made a big impact on me. So I remember he wanted to play it for us and then we'd always request it.
That's a good song as well.
Yeah, it's cool. In the deserts.
What was the first record or the first piece of music that you owned? You went out, you bought, you clutched your money in your hand as you went to the store to buy?
Well, the true answer, which isn't particularly cool, is it was the Batman Forever soundtrack. That was the first CD I bought.
But that's a Prince soundtrack, though. So.
You know, hats off to whoever put that soundtrack together, because there are some really good artists on it. It's everything from, like, Method Man. They made him do a song about the Riddler.
Not his finest moment.
Not his finest moment, but Method Man is on it, Flaming Lips. Kiss from a Rose was the big hit.
Amazing
on that.
Song.
And yeah, you go back and you listen and you're like, this is such a brilliant piece of music. And then I think I also liked the U2 song on that, which was called Hold Me, Kill Me, Kiss
thrill
Me, Thrill Me or
hold
something.
Hold Me, Thrill Me, Kiss Me, something like that. Yeah.
So yeah, I'm a Batman Forever soundtrack guy, and I've been trying to recreate that ever since.
Were you one of those, like, musically obsessed kids? Did you pore over liner notes and get really obsessive with music? Did you have that relationship with it?
Yes, at a certain point. I have a memory that my parents got me a boombox for one of my birthdays. Maybe I was 11 or 12, and I hadn't quite tipped over yet, so I remember being very disappointed that it wasn't comic books. I was really into comic books. Then within a year, I was a total music obsessive, kind of buying everything, buying vinyl, you know, thrift stores, and going really deep. And yeah, even from a young age, I was really interested in vintage music, like in, because I was growing up in the late 90s was kind of when I came online. I was really interested in like garage rock and surf compilations, which was kind of like a golden age where people were, so there was, you know, Back from the Grave, Volume 1, and getting into all that kind of stuff. And that really got me excited about what, you know, what you're talking about, the archival historian nature, because you'd read these liner notes and this guy'd be like, these guys were 15-year-olds at the local high school outside Minneapolis in Minnesota. This was a regional hit. And like that kind of stuff got me really excited back then.
Yeah, and just the broadest possible range. Genre wasn't important. It was just the breadth of music that excited you as well.
Yeah, it turned out that, yeah. I had my brief fixations on understanding the origins of punk or, you know, hip-hop. But yeah, ultimately it was everything.
What was the first gig you went to?
As I recall, it was the Ska Against Racism Festival, which was a touring festival in the late 90s. I must have been young. I must have been 12 or 13. And, you know, that late 90s, there was a ska revival.
Uh-huh.
And that was cool, too, because that also, I was like, what does this mean that this is third wave ska? And my dad had all the Madness and Specials and the Selector. And then he also had, like, the Scottalites and Desmond Decker. So I was kind of, like, putting it together. Oh, so this is Jamaican music from the 60s that sounds like this. And then there was the two-tone and then these kind of, like, you know, New Jersey and Southern California punk rockers doing it. So, Ska Against Racism Festival. I can't exactly remember who was there. Probably Less Than Jake or the Toasters. And, you know, that was interesting. That was a daytime show in New Jersey. And, yeah, I went with some friends.
Did you have that, like, I remember seeing gigs when I was like, in my teens, and there's a bit of you starts thinking, I would like to do that. I don't know how, I don't know where I'd start.
But yeah.
The idea of performing this thing that I love so much, maybe that's something that I could try and will into existence. Did you have that moment?
Totally. Yeah. And my friends and I, we were playing gigs from a very, almost as soon as we were really interested in music, we were playing little gigs. And, you know, all my early bands were with one of my oldest friends, Wes Miles, who has the band Rah Rah Riot. And I don't know, I remember we played at our seventh grade graduation and we would, there were like these little church basement shows. They're very low stakes. And we were talking about it recently. And I was like, how did we even know these things were happening? How did we even like show up at these places? But anyway, we'd go play. We'd have these half-finished songs. And I was weirdly never self-conscious about just going up and making up the words. You know, so it was cool.
Two questions. First of all, what cover versions did you do? Can you remember?
Yeah, I can remember a lot of them. I mean,
what did you choose?
Early days, we did Sunshine of Your Love by Cream.
Nice.
Then as we got older, I remember we did a reggae version of John Barleycorn Must Die, which we knew from Traffic. That's a traditional song. And then I remember being a little bit older and being back in the church basement and playing the song Sugarcube by Yola Tengo. It was all over the place.
Second question, Honest Now, terrible band names.
Yeah.
Because I think it's one of the, occasionally you get a nice one, it's like, oh wow, at 16 they came up with a really band name, but they're normally pretty dreadful. What were your first band names?
I mean, arguably, I'm in a band with a terrible name right now, as we speak.
But you've done that thing.
Yeah, people have forgotten. Don't think about it. Don't think about it too much.
Look, you've done that thing like the Beatles and the Arctic Monkeys. No one even thinks about it anymore. Don't worry about it. Put it aside. However.
The first band, like I told you, I was really interested in kind of 60s garage and surf music. So the first name I ever came up with for a band was the Aquatones. It sounded like a 60s.
Yeah.
Then the next band was called the Sophisticuffs.
Ooh.
We had some good music. There was another band we had called Rickshaw's Dead.
That's
not bad. Those are the main ones I remember.
Let's talk about the Kinks. When did you first hear the Kinks?
Yeah, of course I can wax poetic about the Beatles and the Stones forever, but, you know, the Kinks, people need to be reminded that they're up there with those other two. Like I was saying before, you know, having my parents, it was a big deal when they would say, you should know this song. So I remember my dad saying, do you know the song Waterloo Sunset? And at the time I was obsessed with the Beatles and stuff. And I was like, I don't know that song. He's like, this is good songwriting. And that's really important when you're a kid and you have a parent or an authority figure just tell you, this is good songwriting. Because, you know, that's a different way of thinking about music that maybe you don't think about when you're a little kid. So I was like, all right, this is a good song. And he played it for me, and I was like, wow, this is a good song. And it's very moving, and you're thinking like, yeah, who's Terry? And Terry meets Julie, and what is the tone? It's such a kind of sophisticated tone, too, because you're like, it's sweet and sad and sentimental. And so anyway, that was my entry point. And then when I was, you know, started to have a little allowance or whatever, do odd jobs and make a little money, I bought myself Something Else by the Kinks and the Village Green Preservation Society. And those are still two of my favorite albums of all time. And I can't think of two albums that right at that moment, being like 14 or 15, where I was like, this speaks to me. I listened to those albums inside and out, and I like the singles. But, you know, one of my favorite songs from that era of the Kinks is this one called Animal Farm, which is like kind of a weird one on Village Green Preservation Society. And also, I think I was finally old enough to be up for the challenge where I was like, I don't understand what this is talking about. What do you mean the Village Green Preservation Society? But it made me think, okay. So then I had to, like, you know, ask questions and go backwards and say, so this was a guy from a successful rock band who wrote some like Stone Cold classics in the mid-60s. And now he's talking about God Save the Village Green and China cups and virginity. So it was interesting. I was like, wait, who is this guy? Why does he feel this? What does it mean that he feels this way? You know, so there's like big concepts to start to enter your understanding of music. This world is
big and wide. Vampire Weekend, you didn't meet the guys at the same time. What were your first impressions of each of them? Because everyone in a band has a role. Sometimes it can be a very subtle thing. Someone, maybe they're the diplomat, maybe they're the comedian, maybe they're just the one that sleeps all the time. Everyone's got a thing. Tell me about that.
Let me see. Yeah, when I met all the original members of Vampire Weekend, I mean, an early memory of meeting Ross Tam was that he was somebody who's very interested in recording. I mean, obviously, he's a great musician, but, you know, you don't always meet people who are very interested in recording. I enjoyed talking about music with him, but also I remember being freshman in college, you know, probably maybe 18 or 19, and I was showing him the song that I'd written at the time called Bryn. And this is a few years before Vampire Weekend. And I just remember him being like, well, let's record it. And him having this enthusiasm and confidence that, like, Leonard, let's go record. And I was like, oh, how? And he was like, I've got stuff in my dorm. And so I remember that made a big impression on me, like, oh, this guy's not just a musician, but he understands something about recording. And he also has that attitude, which is so important when you're starting out. Let's go do this. Let's record this. And, you know, that was a precursor to the band by a few years. I met CT the first time because you go at Columbia University, where we went in New York, you go a couple months before school starts if you're in the area and you have some kind of, orientation meeting where they give you a copy of the Iliad. And I remember seeing him, and he had, yeah, they're big on the classics over there. As I recall, it's kind of a distant memory. But I just remember seeing CT, and he had long hair at the time, and I thought maybe he was kind of like a hippie guy or something. And I just remember being like, this guy looks cool. I had no idea that he was a musician or anything like that. And then I remember meeting Bayo early on, and he was in the class below us. Even though we're born the same year, I always think of him as, you know, being like the young guy.
Someone's always got to be the youngest.
Yeah, someone's got to be the youngest. And yeah, I just kind of remember he instantly like knew a lot about music. I was making a lot of beats in my dorm room at the time. And I remember him saying like, and you know, this is for, you know, whatever this was, 2003, 2004, some of this early days for people in the U.S. to know anything about grime or something. But people were starting to get excited about Dizzy Rascal, XL Recordings. Uh-huh. I saw his first concert in New York.
What was that like?
He performed on a bed of a truck. It was very exciting. I also saw The Streets' first concert. So whatever, I was interested in that stuff. And I remember making beats in my dorm, whatever I was working on. I remember talking to Bayo, and he was kind of like, I heard you were working on something. I said, yeah. And he says, that sounds very like UK influence. And I was like, okay. Interesting. Like, yeah, he's an extremely intelligent guy with an amazing memory and just very encyclopedic knowledge of stuff. And then the fact that he was studying Russian made an impact on me because I was like, okay, serious. I like that.
Should we do first rehearsal or first gig? Which one do you remember? There tends to be like, it goes one or two ways. The first gig is like, they look at each other and they went, yeah, this is a thing. It's happening. Or they look at each other and go, this is awful.
Yeah.
But we're quite enjoying this, so we're going to keep doing it till it's not awful.
There was something there. I hadn't really had a band in a few years since high school. You know, like I said, I'd done a bit of recording with Rostam. I'd had some other groups and stuff, but not like a band. So there's something about getting back together and suddenly having a clearer focus. And one thing I know for sure is that at our first rehearsal, there was Oxford comma. Like I'd written that on my parents' piano, and then we actually didn't even have a full, I think that might have just been in my dorm, and I had this little Casio keyboard, and there was something about that song that, and I don't know, I was starting to think a little bit differently about songwriting and music. So there's something about that song where I was kind of like, this feels like, I don't know, a blueprint or something, you know? So it wasn't one of those bands where you have a few years of like, what's our sound? Yeah, there's something about that song Oxford comma where that gave me some, well, I already knew I liked the song, but then hearing everybody play it and kind of bring their magic to it, that gave me some like real confidence. So there was like a vibe for sure.
That's kind of cool. A song you played at your first rehearsal is still a song you can break out at a concert now and know everyone's going to get off on it.
Yeah.
That's kind of cool.
No, totally.
Let's do another artist. Leonard Cohen.
Yeah.
Why is Leonard Cohen on your list? And what track should we play, I guess, is the question as well.
Well, I mean, Leonard Cohen, I started to get into probably in college, and he's just one of those artists that kind of feels like a lifetime friend or something. You know, I'm still getting deeper into these like early 2000s albums. You know, when I was in my 20s, I don't know if I was ready to hear, you know.
You want it darker. I'm not ready for that yet.
Yeah. But what I first got into the like 70s stuff. Well, and then the 60s, of course, like Suzanne and stuff like that. But there was one song in particular called, what's the official title? It's like Sing Another Song, Boys. That's such a weird song. And I was so struck by his way with words, obviously. I'm not the first to say that. And yeah, the kind of poetry of it and the kind of seriousness of it. And then it's just, he's just one of those artists that I wasn't always ready for parts of his career. Like when I loved the kind of 60s and 70s stuff, I could not understand the 80s, the synth stuff. Mm-hmm. I hated the production. And now that's some of my favorite stuff.
Like, it gets you, doesn't it?
Yeah. And then you kind of realize, like, naturally as an artist, when you grow older and you look at somebody like Leonard Cohen, you're like, this guy was in his 50s and he wrote Everybody Knows. And it holds up and it's cool. And he always had something to say. And yeah, he's just a huge inspiration as a poet, as a songwriter, as a person. And I've always loved people who take breaks. So even though apparently he got ripped off very badly by his business manager, this idea that this guy was on the spiritual quest and he went up Mount Baldy in Southern California for however many years, there's also something about that as I got a little bit older that added something to just my fascination with him as a human being.
Yeah. It's the humor for me as well. Like when I was younger, I didn't get the humor. Then you grow up and you're like, oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of wit in that stuff.
Absolutely.
Beneath the darkness.
Let's sing another song, boys.
That first record, I mean, I was listening to it again today. It sounds so different, so complete and so realized. But like, how do you feel you cope with the attention that came along afterwards? Because there was a lot of attention.
I think one difficulty for me in particular was I thought it was so fun and funny to have this concept of a preppy band and dressing, you know, one rule that we set early on was no t-shirts. Because I just looked around, so everybody's wearing t-shirts all the time. We should just wear button-down shirts, which of course has a long history, you know. But at the time, it felt pretty novel. And especially then, there are all these great New York bands, Strokes and Interpol and stuff. There were t-shirts and leather jackets. It was time for something new. So I thought there was obviously something kind of funny and whimsical about what we were doing. And when I first encountered people who just could not sense any humor and be like, well, this is, what is this music about being rich at a fancy school? And I was like, no, it's supposed to be like a critique of that or whatever. I don't know. So anyway, that was a little bit disorienting the first. But also, that's why it's so great that with your first album, you go in a little bit blind.
Yeah.
I'm thankful for that, that we could develop a sound and a world without, you know, it probably would have been a bit shyer if we had been around for years and years. You know, like sometimes now people have a million singles and then they drop the album. There's something nice about being a little bit insulated from opinions and just kind of coming out.
Yeah, it's more instinctive, isn't it?
Yeah.
Often the first instinct is the best one and you overthink things less. And I guess the more successful you get, the harder it is to get away from that stuff and just keep on moving forward, following the thing that makes you do good work in the first place.
Yeah, and I think that album has a very strong aesthetic, musically, production-wise, the way we dressed, the imagery we used. And I think that's why there's something, I hate to say pure, but there's something just very coherent about that album.
That's a good rock critic word,
yeah.
But it's right. Contra, which was your second record in 2010, that was your first album to go to number one in the States, which is clearly like a big milestone. Did that kind of change things for you and the band?
Yeah, and well, and we were lucky. We just happened to be in this funny period in between Napster and Spotify.
Okay.
I always think about that, you know, that was a time where suddenly pop stars didn't know how to sell records anymore, but indie bands did, so... Especially back then, remember everybody was talking about, oh, nobody buys music anymore and how's everybody going to make money and stuff? And, oh, do you ever think you might have made more money if you came out in the 90s? And I said, who knows what would have happened to us in the 90s? We might have gone nowhere in the 90s. So, you know, I've always had a deep sense of this is the time we were born into, the positives and the negatives. It was all meant to be.
What do you think it says about where we were that people responded to that album so well? Because I've got a theory, but I think it's basically any walls or barriers between what you might like and what you could access just went.
Yeah.
And you're a band that are nothing if not eclectic in your approach and use of melody and use of percussion, use of everything. And I think that's a really free record.
Mm. Yeah, I think the second one, it's definitely pushed in new directions. It came very hot on the heels of the first record, too. When I look back on that, I'm like, I can't believe we got it out so quickly. It's... just under 2 years, which when you consider how much touring we did, was stressful to get it done in time. But yeah, that came out in 2010. Those years were like the epitome of what you're talking about, this kind of a freewheeling kind of internet, everything's on the table kind of feel. Absolutely.
I was going to ask you about, because it's all firsts, I'm going to ask you about your first Grammy. And I was watching back, I was watching the kind of ceremony.
Uh-huh.
What do you remember from that night? Because it's a very strange...
Yeah, and the category that we've won in is Best Alternative Album, so that's in the pre-televised ceremony, mm-hmm. which is just how I like it. I'm a pre-televised kind of guy. It feels a little bit kind of more chaotic and less official or something than the big televised mm-hmm. ceremony. Luckily, we'd been there once before because Contra was nominated for a Grammy. So, you know, sometimes you have to, and at first you're like, oh, so weird, oh, whatever. And then you go and you lose and you realize, oh, it's kind of funny to actually show up somewhere just to lose. And then you realize, okay, you need to rethink this. So the main thing that comes to mind is that somebody was like, you guys want a stylist the first time in the Grammys? Oh, we probably should, you know, dress up nice. I remember going the first time and realizing, next time I just want to wear a sweater. Not take it as seriously, not because I have anything against the Grammys, but just because I realized it's music. You're supposed to be yourself, you know, and you see everybody, you know, people walk around with cowboy hats and leather jackets and, you know, bizarre couture and all this stuff. And you realize, okay, the same reason why sometimes people hate on the Grammys is also the charm, is that it's totally incoherent. They're trying to do something about music and they have to come up with so many categories to include the whole wide world of music. Like, the Oscars, I don't know, somehow there's consensus in the Oscars, or maybe they manufacture consensus, but music is so crazy, so it's like they have, you know, folk and alternate. It's, so anyway, I just, pulling up to the Modern Vampires one, that's my main thought. I remember, just wear a sweater. That's what I did.
Because I was watching the kind of, the pre and post interviews are up online, and you kind of got this sort of gentle sort of bemusement. You've got the two people interviewing you who are clearly like up there mm-hmm. in the kind of... hype stakes, and you guys are just like, yeah, this is just fine. It's nice. It's quite weird.
Yeah.
And the discrepancy between the event and you.
You know, I guess it's just like life. There's thousands of people at the Grammys. Everybody's having a different experience. And I think you got to have a sense of amusement.
Father of the Bride was the first album without Rostam, and any group you change someone, you're not just removing that person, you're changing, even if it's in the best possible terms, you're changing everybody.
And it was a lot of things at once. It's not just having the lineup change. That was also the first album in our 30s after, I don't know, I also had such a sense of completion after Modern Vampires, you know? Always thought about like a bit of a trilogy. Yeah. So that felt kind of done. And, you know, and then you get into your 30s and you have to think a little bit more about how long are we going to be doing this and what type of music should we make to allow ourselves to enjoy it and to feel like we're telling a story that goes beyond youthful indie shenanigans. So it was the post-shenanigans era. And so on Father the Bride, I think there was also a little bit of premature dad rock, partially because I was kind of like, I almost wanted to fast forward to something. And also it felt like after those first three albums, it just kind of felt time to make like a sprawling kind of genre hopping album. You only have a few chances in your career to make an album like that,
yeah,
where you still have people's ears. I mean, you could drop that on your 12th album. Fourth album is better. So I don't know. It felt like this cool moment to kind of have fun with songwriting and kind of get into something different. I think the thing with Vampire Weekend is we always just have to look for what feels fresh to us in that moment. That's the only thing that's going to keep this thing going. And that was the moment, I think, where we also kind of decoupled from, I don't know, like the culture by and large or something.
But was there a point, because you were stretched out in so many different directions and personally done other creative projects, was there a moment when you were like, I don't know if going back to Vampire Weekend or that setup, that environment is really something that I want to do? Was there ever a question there?
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, there's many times in my life I've been a hardcore overthinker. So there's times I thought, oh, maybe I don't want to do the band anymore. Maybe it makes more sense as a solo project. Maybe it makes sense to start something else. But ultimately what I've come back to is that I've had such strong feelings about how each album represents a chapter. And no matter who I'm working with or what it sounds like, I ultimately decided that's something that I love too much to kind of let go of. And of course, the camaraderie, and I love that. But, you know, just sometimes you have to interrogate yourself. What do I actually have strong feelings about? Mm-hmm. And sometimes I don't have strong feelings, and I stop working for a few months, which I'm very, very lucky to be able to do because I hate, like, being on the clock. So I realized that after those first three albums, I had to think, is there a fourth chapter? And then I started to feel like there really is a fourth chapter. I can feel it. And actually, even back then, I kind of had an idea what this album, the current one, Only God Was Above Us, might be like. I started to see how, well, if we go there, we can come round here. And even now, you know, as we've rolled this album out, of course, what am I obsessively thinking about albums 6 and 7? I have my mood boards.
That's kind of cool, though. That's nice. There's a lineage going forward.
And I realized that's what I like. Yeah. It's hard. You get thrust into an industry, this is true of any job, and maybe at first you're excited about it, and then you have to realize, well, what do I really like about this? Do I like everything about it? I didn't get into music because I love being on stage. I've grown to enjoy it, but like, people sometimes think I'm being ice cold when I say this, but if you told me I could never do a show for the rest of my life, I would say fine.
Really?
I would still want to get together with the guys, but we could just get buffalo wings. You know what I mean? Yeah, and then of course, you know, it's like a business too. I'm putting aside practical concerns.
Yeah, sure,
but I'm
sure.
Just see, you know, when some people say, man, you get on that stage, nothing compares to that feeling. You know, you've been on a planes, trains, buses, you're burned out, bad food, and then you get on that stage, you forget all about that. I'm always like, what are you talking about? I can think of 10 better feelings than that.
So, Only God Was Above Us, was this a fun one to do? Did it happen easily, this record?
It did. It happened somewhat easily. The final year for us, that would probably be the final month for other people, but the final year for us is never exactly pleasant because that's when you're listening to 20 different mixes and starting to go insane and listening on different speakers and like, wait, is it distorted? I'll never like that part.
But you obsess over that part?
Yeah. And I'm lucky that R.L. Rekshaw, the producer, he obsesses even more than me. So that's helpful. But yeah, that part's never fun. Mixing and mastering, that's technical. Up until then, nah, we have a ball. Trying different versions, experimenting. And again, that's because we take a leisurely pace. And this record probably, if we'd had that same kind of youthful, oh my God, we got to do this. Like, we can't let the time pass. Like, that's how I felt during Contra. So if we'd had that kind of energy, maybe this record could have come out a few years ago. I don't think it would have been as good, but it's just not where we're at. And, you know, there's a lot of reasons, like, my wife got some jobs that took the family abroad, 6 months in London, 6 months in Tokyo. And those are all very cool places to live. Truly, if I'd been in my 20s, I'd be like, I don't know if I can be in Tokyo for sale. That's cool, you know, but like, I got to go work. Whereas now I just felt like this is meant to be. This time away will be great. And then it actually turned out cool because then Ariel came to both places and we recorded in those places. But it naturally injected these nice months-long periods of being away from the music, listening to the demos on walks, you know, all the stuff that that helps.
And the first time you listen to it on the big speakers or whatever, and you're like, the sequencing is done, it's mastered. Tell me about how that felt as the finished thing.
It just felt very right. Maybe this is also just being older. You know, it's like we're comparing albums, but at the same time, you're also comparing just, you know, how your nervous system functions at age 39 versus 23, you know, for instance. And hopefully if you're lucky, it's been a positive journey. I've had a lot of conversations with everybody involved with this record where when we've finally heard, you know, the vinyl test pressing or something, just a sense of we made this exactly how we wanted to make it. And, you know, like I said, about decoupling a little bit from culture or just realizing like that's cool, but really just a sense of accomplishment. Like, you know, back in the day, we'd probably talk for hours. Well, what do you think people think about it? You think that critical like it? Well, I don't know. He didn't like that record, so he might, you know, we used to have those conversations, whereas now when we kind of listen to the test pressing or play it for some people and we're all together in a positive way with this record, we really had a sense of like, we did it exactly what we want. Well, what do you think people are going to think? Who cares? You know, that's a little bit where we've gotten to, which is where you have to get to.
And the very last thing, what's the final song we should play? What should we go out on? It can be anything, something you've heard this morning or something you've loved your whole life. What should we finish on?
Okay, I'll tell you one thing. Our U.S. tour is a real patchwork of openers because we like to do special things in different cities. For whatever reason, our L.A. show became Ska Night, and the bill is Voodoo Glow Skulls, who are Southern California ska punk band, love since childhood, English Beat, a band my dad got me into, also iconic in us. So that became Ska Night. So I've been going through a big ska revival in my house. And, you know, like I said earlier, that's music that's been very meaningful to me my whole life. And, you know, the great thing about ska and rock steady is there's just so much of it. You know, Prince Buster, legendary artist. I knew some of his music growing up, but I don't know. There's a song I heard for the first time recently called Sit and Wonder. It's just so cool. There's something about like the delivery, Prince Buster and Baba Brooks. There's something very like modern about it in a way to me. Anyway, that's been on repeat since I've got ska on the brain again.
Then that's the last song we shall play. It's been good to speak to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.